Hi, everybody. I hope you can hear me well. Welcome to the third day of the Lumix Festival 2020. I'm Malte. I'm part of the Lumix team. It's been several months now that we have been working on a digital version of the Lumix Festival. And even though we would have loved to welcome all of you to the Expo Plaza in Hannover right here, I'm very happy that we managed to put much of it or much of what we had online. And with this series of live talks, we're even able to bring back a bit of the exchanges, the discussions, and the community feeling. Most of what would have been the Lumix Festival is now online, available at lumix-festival.de. There you can see over 80 projects from all over the world, very diverse approaches and visual languages from young storytellers. This year is a bit special in that there's a new addition to the program, which I'm very fond of, and that is called New Perspectives in Documentary Practices. It's a platform that we established as a place that aims to show and discuss contemporary developments in documentary photography and visual journalism. And we are most happy that Iris Sikking agreed to be our very first guest curator. And for what was meant to be an exhibition to take place in Hannover, she proposed a list of 12 works by 13 artists, with two of whom, Lisa Barnard and Robert Knoth, she will speak today. Iris Sikking is an Amsterdam-based curator, lecturer, and writer. She positions herself in the overlapping field of photography, film, and digital art. In 2019, she co-edited the book Why Exhibit? Positions on Exhibiting Photographies, together with Anna Kaiser Rastenberger, and was in 2018 the chief curator for the Krakow Photo Month. Lisa Barnard, one of the panelists and also in the selection for the platform, places her photographic practice in the genre of photography in the sense that her work discusses real events. She broadens the genre, though, by embracing complex and innovative visual strategies that utilize both traditional documentary techniques with more contemporary and conceptually rigorous forms of representation. Robert Knoth, together with his partner Antoinette de Jong, has worked, traveled, and lived in conflict areas in Africa, the former Soviet Union, and Asia, including Afghanistan under the Taliban reign. In the 1990s, and reported for national and international media. Since then, both have adapted to technological developments and the internet by starting to experiment more with layered forms of storytelling and to merge documentary approaches with those from contemporary art. I'm very happy to have all of you here. And to our audience, as I said, we want this to be a place of discussions, a place for discussion. So please feel free to pose any questions you have into the chat, and I will get back to them later and pose them to the three, to which I now give the word. So Iris, please feel free to take over.
Yes, hello. Thank you so much, Malte, for this wonderful introduction. And thank you, Robert and Lisa, for being here. Well, a warm welcome for everyone, also to the invisible audience. It's really strange not to see you, but I know you're there. And I hope you will enjoy our talk, our discussion. And as Malte was already mentioning, please feel free to put your questions in the chat. And during the talk, we can address those. I find it amazing to have Lisa and Robert here together. And of course, as Malte was already mentioning, Robert is always collaborating with Robert, but we thought it for this format, it would be easier to have person. So Robert is representing Antoinette as well. Robert is, by the way, in my living room because his internet at home is not so good. So we decided to do it here. So I'm upstairs somewhere and Antoinette is in the kitchen preparing a meal or my husband is preparing a meal for us after the talk. And Lisa is in the UK. She's living there in the southern part of the UK. And I just heard that she was almost not able to make it because she had a car well, was almost down at the motorway in southern England. So I'm really happy that you made it and we are all here. I know you both for a couple of years, and especially with Robert and Antoinette. I'm collaborating since 2012 already. But I will give a short introduction to the two of you and also introduce your project very briefly so you can build on that and address your projects in more detail. Both of you have been working on very complex stories of our time, of our times, and each of you is tracking the history and value of a product, in fact. A product that turns out to be a major player in today's global society. It's either gold, as in Lisa Barnard's project, the canary and the hammer. Gold is a mineral we all like to possess. And then Robert and Antoinette's project, Poppy, that we will talk about today, is talking about opium, a substance for heroin, which is, of course, as we all know, an addictive drug. We live in fragmentary times. If there's one thing that applies to both you photographers here at my table and in my computer, Lisa, you both try to make sense of the world around us. Because although we all think we have a clear view of what's going on, mainly thanks to the flow of information in the virtual sphere, we have to conclude that we are only able to grasp some snippets of a bigger whole. And the bigger stories are around, but they are so complex today that we can also grasp some fragments. So the concept of fragmentation has been proved key for the narrative structure of both the projects, and we will certainly address that. I think I can speak for the two of you if I say that about a decade ago, you were both very eager to break out of the photojournalistic realm. And we will address that later on. And by now you have find your own visual approach in producing, conceptualizing and disseminating your projects. So we will talk also about the choices you've made for certain platforms, books, exhibitions, interactive websites. We will talk about the value of in-depth research and how you both manage to keep a balance between the stories you want to tell about the ordinary people and the unraveling of certain mechanisms in our global society. Also, we discussed the tension between the hyper-reality of journalism and the more abstract qualities of art and literature, which requires a more self-reflexive documentary approach. I hope to address those things via the questions later on. For now, I will give a brief introduction to Poppy, followed by a brief introduction to the canary and the hammer, and then I will give the word to Lisa. But first, poppy. Poppy starts with a beautiful flower, the poppy flower. These flowers contain opium, which is the raw material of heroin. However, this story is less about the heroin production itself. Rather, it's about the thrills along which the heroin is reaching and affecting many people. In Poppy, we see the drug trafficking, how it arrives in the streets of London, along the way, passing Kosovo, Odessa, Somalia, Kyrgyzstan, Berlin, Rotterdam, just to name a few of the places where Robert and Antoinette have been to cover their story. With the writings in the book or the voiceover in the interactive and the installation, they show us a very dark version of the ancient Silk Road. Then I turn to the Canary and the Hammer, which is a story about gold and how it shaped our society. From a status symbol to the uses in the field of the high-tech industry, it is all shown, it all passes by in the project of Lisa Barnard. She not only looked, therefore, at the value of gold today and how it amplifies greed and political power, but she also traced the history of the material and its mining process. Lisa, with your amazing images and the addition of archival material and your own writings, you provide us in the end with a deep insight in how gold intersects with our global economy. I would now like to give the word to Lisa. You can briefly continue talking about it, and you can give a cue to Malte and he will start then the video. So I leave it up to you at which point that is. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Iris. Nice to see you, Robert.
Hello, hi.
Hi, really nice to be here. Thanks everybody for attending on a Sunday afternoon. So the project has two forms. It has this sort of digital content, and it's also in a more material form, a book published with MacBooks. And I suppose the genesis of the project for me really was the 2008 financial crisis. And personally, I was very much affected by the sort of crash in the markets. You know, I sort of lost a home, although I did manage to get some of it back. But financially, I was very hit by this. And I noticed that gold was very stable throughout. And actually, during a financial crisis, everybody buys gold. And I was quite interested in sort of contradiction between fiat currency and gold. So I started looking at the history of gold and discovered obviously two main events, one of which was the plundering of South America by Francisco Pizarro. And the second was our journey to North America to look for gold, which was commissioned by James I for the Virginia Mining Company, who went to North America to look for gold. And of course, they didn't find gold. They found an area that was really inhospitable and Pocahontas, the character of Pocahontas. And I sort of latched onto her as a female protagonist. And then the work sort of snowballed from there, really. And I looked at her story and a number of other stories that were really connected to this idea of the materiality of gold and how it's really embedded within our society, and it's hidden. Its material evidence is actually hidden. So it sort of is a metal that is has this sort of inherent contradiction. It's incredibly valuable, and we do value it, but it's also very much hidden in the medical industrial complex, general military industrial complex. It's been a key component actually for the coronavirus developments that have happened with to find you know, a drug that prevents us from catching it. Can't remember what the word is suddenly. So I'm really interested in how it's embedded within society, and at the same time how that reflects on visual imagery and how photography can or cannot show what is hidden in the world. So it's that sort of inherent contradiction. I don't know how much more you want me to say, really, Iris. I mean, I can go on, but that's like a little introduction.
Yeah, no, this is very, very good to hear this. I think it's good to go to the website, because in fact, you started this project by compiling an interactive website, first just for research reasons. And we will show this film, which shows the navigation and what is all there in the website. So we keep silence for a moment so Malte can start the video.
Eros is an S-type near-Earth asteroid that was discovered in 1898. It is thought to contain 20,000 billion kilograms of valuable minerals, such as aluminium, platinum, and gold.
The reach of capitalism into the universe and make celestial bodies a source of income. President Barack Obama signed an act giving U.S. companies the right to the commercial exploration of asteroids and other bodies in space. The law states U.S. citizens are entitled to own and sell the resources they obtain. The move has thrilled some spots.
Hong Kong serves as one of the major ports for entry of e-waste into China. Trucks or ships of containers are transported to the new territories of northern Hong Kong, often falsely labelled as raw plastics to comply with customs, and then smuggled over the border. Tell when they cut it, you see my grandmama hate it, but my little mama love it, cause when I open up your mouth, your grill gleaming, she won. I stay low from the chief end. I got a grill I call Penny Candy, you know what that Betts means? Like is the oldest surviving precious metal refining and dealing business in the UK. Since the middle of the 18th century, they have owned a smelting and refining business designed to recover gold and silver ores and precious metals from wastes being produced in Birmingham's jewellery quarter. This particular refinery is based just outside Buxton, and although their chemical processes to extract gold is secret, there were notable similarities with the Aqua Regia. Sutrami is a mining organization based within the Atacama Desert of central Peru. Founded in 1989, the organization was established in response to the falling price of gold in the 1970s and the nationalization of mining by the Peruvian government, becoming the first artisanal and small-scale mining company of the country. Sutrami employs 300 miners, a group of engineers, and a group of 180 women known locally as the palaqueras, or mineral sorters, who sort the ore on the surface for pieces containing gold.
What is freedom? Ye can tell that which slavery is too well, for its very name has grown to an echo of your own. 'Tis to work and have such pay as just keeps life from day to day in your limbs, as in a cell for the tyrant's use to dwell, so that ye for them are made, loom and plough and sword and spade, with or without your own will bent, to their defence and nourishment. 'Tis to see your children weak with their mother's pine.
This wireframe landscape depicts the gold price from 1257 to 2016, showing the peaks and troughs of gold in relation to global events.
Protect the position of the American dollar as a pillar of monetary stability around the world. In the past 7 years, there's been an average of one international monetary crisis every year. Now, who gains from these crises? Not the working man.
Okay. It's a little brief introduction.
Yeah, this is a lovely way to see how the website works. I mean, there's so many different elements in it. So I would just go, if you allow me, to the way you want to show this in a physical space. That was already showed that way in Derby at the Format Festival.
Yeah.
And we were planning to do that again in Hannover. In a sec, I will share my screen. There are two images of that. And then I would like to I would like you to introduce the book. And then later on, I will come back to the website when we also have seen the interactive of Robert. So I'm going to share my screen. Here they are, the first images of the installation. Go ahead, Lisa.
Okay, so one of the things that was really important for me was that the project should be free. It was to be sort of non-hierarchical. I really wanted to sort of look at this idea of materiality in relationship to photography. And I also wanted to immerse the viewer in a world of sort of the hidden, the invisibility of gold. So the best way I felt to do that was to create this sort of immersive space. So it's a box that you walk into, and there are three screens that, and then an interaction trackpad on the pillar there, and you can navigate yourself around the website and explore it and listen to some of the stories and look at the different types of imagery. So it's not until you actually go into the space that actually you understand that there is, you know, an unfamiliar, I suppose, form of documentary in there. I was really keen to make something a little bit unsettling and a little bit immersive, a little bit claustrophobic, so that it does something that's that questions really our relationship to the screen as you're standing in there. You know, how do you navigate these systems? How is gold important in that navigation? I mean, I think we're going to talk a little bit more about this idea of fragmentation and society, yeah. But that's a really important aspect of the project for me, is to look at the materiality of gold in relationship to the screen.
Okay, I will turn indeed to the book, because it has been, it took you a few years to think, do I want a book or not, and why? And finally, it came out, was published by Mac, I believe in 2019, so just a year ago. I have 7 images here to show, so please go ahead and introduce the concept of the book, which is a bit differently, of course.
Yeah, and I think that that's something that I'm really interested in relation to documentary, is that the work that you make doesn't just have one, you know, visual output. You don't have to output a work so that it always looks the same. It should, in my opinion, respond to the medium in which it's being looked at. So if you're making work for the screen, it should look and feel differently to how it is in a book. And I think quite often documentary photographers produce something, they show it on the website, and then it looks very familiar in the book. And I wanted to treat the publication differently, and Michael Mack was very keen to reference the research that I had done. I mean, the previous book, The Hyenas of the Battlefield, Machines in the Garden, was a really sort of in-depth look at the military industrial complex in relation to drones. So there was a lot of text in it, there were lots of interviews, lots of transcripts, and this book is exactly the same, so that you have an image that's, you know, relatively aesthetic, but you also have a lot of text. And also I was keen to really reference the impossibilities of documenting in other parts of the world, especially within this period of history, is that, you know, we have a responsibility as documentary photographers to not subjugate in the way that photography has been used in the past. And that's pretty, it's very difficult for photographers to do that, because, you know, you have to work with people in order to tell their stories, but then how do you represent those people and those ideas if, you know, and, you know, historically portraiture has always been that mode in which we tell somebody's mm-hmm. story, you know, you show an image of somebody and then you have their text or whatever. But what I've done with these images is I put gold leaf, fair trade gold leaf, actually from the mine in which the women were working, in order to sort of, I suppose, ironically look at that relationship between photography and value, and also the subjugation of the women. So it was really important for me to make sure that the viewers were understanding how impossible the task of a documentary photographer is to represent women and people that are working in these communities properly. And then there's lots of text, lots of historical text, lots of diagrams, lots of access to archives. Again, it's really important for me not to just show the imagery of the places, but to give a bit more of a background about the history and the research involved as to why I got to these places and the importance and relevance of those places. But I suppose beyond anything, the book is this material object.
Yeah.
And, you know, the process of looking through a book is about the value of holding that, I suppose, that object. And that's very similar to photography. Part of the value of photography is, you know, its material value on the walls in the gallery, but also its very specific financial value. And documentary has sort of historically slightly suffered from that, unlike art photography, if you like, that has somehow more monetary value because it slips into that system more readily. So I did engage with different ways of representing ideas. You just saw some images. If you go back one, Iris, this is a Nikon stereoscopic camera. It's a very old camera and it takes two images and they are then three-dimensional. And that's very much sort of referencing, I suppose, early Muybridge and Carlton Watkins, who were all taking sort of stereoscopic images of North America, which is where these images are from. In a way of, again, I suppose, pointing us to sort of this relationship between the materiality and the computer screen, and whether that's, you know, something that's important within a publication, if you like. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, yeah, engaging with characters and I don't know what the last slide is. Yeah, and I suppose all the time I'm sort of moving in and out of this sort of fictional and documentary aspect to sort of labour this idea of the impossibilities of telling the truth about something. You know, it's very difficult. There is never one definitive truth. And yes, a lot of documentary historically has always been presented as that my way or the highway, if you like, and it's not as straightforward, because if you have a position of power as a photographer, then you have the truth, but of course that's just one truth among multiple truths. So the book sort of tries to reference that sort of impossibility of finding, you know, one narrative or one way of talking about the subject. So I look at really different styles of photographing. There's not just one style. And then I worked quite closely with a couple of research universities, and this is BBI Solutions in Cardiff, who are making gold nanoparticles for assays for those testing for Ebola and obviously now for COVID pregnancy tests. So it's a really vital component within a lot of the medical industrial complex. So for example, you know, cancer treatment now is very much targeted to tumors, and that all happens from gold, and it's, you know, very strange qualities that it has to effervesce whilst in the body. It gives off light, which in case, you know, you can have targeted systems to parts of the body. It's a fascinating material. So hopefully the book sort of references some of those relationships. And of course, there's a strand all the way through as I'm looking at the hidden workforce of women within the book, and within that sort of, this very sort of high-powered industry, you know, there's always a workforce behind, and a lot of those tend to be women that are hidden and subjugated.
Okay,
just a brief overview.
Thank you so much. I think it's good to turn to the Poppy project. There are a lot of similarities in both the way you approach reality and what kind of techniques you use and modes of representation. So I think it's good to turn to you, Robert. We also have a film that shows how the interaction is and the navigation is taking place on the website. And it was also the idea to show the interactive in the exhibition in Hanover. So that's why I like to focus on that first. And I also think it's key to tell, just before you start, Malte, wait just a second. It's key to tell that the voice that you hear is Antoinette's voice. She's also the voiceover of the installation and also in the interactive. Robert, do you want to add a few words, or do you want us to start with the video right away?
Well, Poppy is not so much a project about heroin itself or the drug trade. It is more a story about the framework in which various actors involved in trafficking is. So it tries to show this framework and a nexus between organized crime and specifically war, that groups as the Taliban, Al-Qaeda are heavily involved in the drugs trafficking or ISIS, and how that has created a global economy of illicit goods, which is destabilizing large parts of the world. So it's a story about how the war in Afghanistan, which is for a very large part funded by drugs trafficking. And Afghanistan has replicated itself, or the war in Afghanistan has replicated itself across the globe. You see the same phenomenon or blueprint of the war in Syria. You see it in Libya, you see it in Mali. And it's gaining traction all over the world. So it's not so much about the drugs itself, but about the framework and how it's linked to our everyday lives in a globalized world.
Mm-hmm. Maybe it's good then to add as well that in 2012 you launched the book and the exhibition, the installation, and then only later on the interactive. Maybe that's good to give some more information about how that worked and why you decided to make a website a few years later.
Yeah, we started with the whole project started with a regular newspaper feature about the drugs, about the opium production in Afghanistan. And 5-6 years later, we decided to do a story about the drug trafficking and outside of Afghanistan and how that is affecting the rest of the world. We found out that the fallout of the Afghan war outside of Afghanistan was much bigger than inside of Afghanistan. There's about 100,000 people dying of Afghan heroin every year. So that's a lot of more people dying because of that war outside of Afghanistan than inside of Afghanistan. And by 2012, we produced a book and a video installation, and both work on a different level. So the book is a far more intellectual approach. It provides you a lot of information and a historical timeline of the war in Afghanistan. And the interactive, or no, the video installation is much more a very fluid story. And it serves more to get a feeling across rather than actual information.
Yeah. We can talk about that a bit later if I show the images, but maybe it's good to show the film now to see the navigation on the interactive website.
What do 39 luxury villas on Palm Island in Dubai have to do with 2 million drug addicts in Russia? Why did the Americans and NATO do next to nothing to stop the poppy trade? And what are drug lords doing in the government of Tajikistan? The explosive growth of the worldwide heroin trade is a heritage of the Afghan War. Soviet soldiers brought the drugs back home, thus creating huge new markets. The Afghan warlords jumped on the bandwagon, trafficking heroin to finance their jihad. A quarter of the current drug export crosses Central Asia into Russia and Ukraine. Follow the northern route and discover how heroin trade leaves a trail of destruction and misery across the former Soviet republics.
کوکنار یک وقت 15,000 پاوش آمد.
کوکنار is poppy?
Yeah, کوکنار.
Oh, okay. This is gandul. It's nothing.
آخ نباشه یه چیز نمیشه. کلاً چیز خراب میشه.
He says that if there was no water, there was no man, no animal, nothing, no people.
But next to the gandum, next to the wheat fields, there is the poppy field, and that is a little bit green. Why is that?
When you didn't give in 50 or 20 days the water for him, you say that poppy is a little stronger than wheat.
Powerful warlords and big drug traffickers earn millions, but even the farmers profit. Juma Khan has come from the south with a big group of men to work in the opium harvest. He's earned good money, just offered me a ride on his new motorbike. It cost him $2,400. During the harvest, the workers lick their opium-covered fingers, and they're all addicted now. One of them says it's no problem at all. He says as long as you drink buttermilk with herbs, you stay healthy. Captain Doroyev, how much do you get paid?
Ich mach viel. Oh,
no, it's a secret.
Secret? Oh.
It's a secret.
Is it a secret above 300? Since the breakup of the Soviet Union, a self-destructive subculture has taken hold, much as it did in the 1980s in Western Europe. Unemployment, poverty, drug abuse, prostitution, or threatening an entire generation.
I think that it is not a problem for a person, HIV. The problem is how person look at this fact. Or we began to live, really to live, or it is end of life, and with HIV I have no future. I don't know, I believe that God doesn't want to make me with HIV and my child.
Киса, ты тоже выбрал такое время для себя. Где-то же не хутором свести, когда мне тут кипно.
Слушай, я рабочий день сегодня оставил, специально посвятил этому вопросу. Они что сюда, порожники приехали гонять или что?
А вы не начать, ну младше.
Маша thinks that she's pregnant. It's possible.
Думаю, что это возможно. Возможно.
She, maybe she's not sure.
Я же не знаю.
She doesn't know.
But it looks swollen.
My God. Can you imagine?
No.
All right. Thank you for the video, Malte. Well, Robert, I'm going to try and share my screen again. There are first some images of the book because mm-hmm. I think that is in fact where we started.
Yeah.
And then there are like three images of the installation. So let's run through that before we open up and I start some more general or start more questions and we go more in depth on the and we find out more about the interactives of both artists here. Here you go.
Yeah, perhaps it's better to start with the second one. I mean, this is obviously the so what you see now is the it's basically the basis of the book. Our biggest problem was how do you put 20 years of work, which is almost a lifetime, into a cohesive narrative. And we tried to do that for a very long time. And at some point we just gave up on the whole thing and decided to, that as a viewer, you just had to open the book, get into the car and just go all in one go to the end of the book and then get out and say, poo-poo, that was a rough ride. And we decided to create a non-linear timeline. So you move from Afghanistan 93 to the Ukraine in 2007, which are related, but then again, they're not related either. From there, you move to Somalia, to Kosovo, in order to create an in-depth story about how long this problem has been going on. And of course, Afghanistan got into the news back in 2001 with the 9/11 attacks on the World Trade Center. But the problem in Afghanistan itself started much earlier. And that became a major part of our project to make the argument that yes, we're all talking about Afghanistan, it's in the daily news, but long time before 2001, the whole story started. And for us, if you go back to the page, for us, it also was a discovery while doing research about the project that, for me, for instance, I covered the war in Kosovo in 2008. That was basically a civil war. But during our research, we found out that a large part of the war, again, was financed by heroin trafficking. The same about Somalia, the same in Pakistan, Tajikistan. So at some point, we discovered that for most of our career, we had been walking around in one and the same story, which is the connection between war and organized crime and how they influence each other. And that proved to be the right angle to write a relevant story about Afghanistan. And we wanted to get away from, you know, all the stories about how women are treated, or whether it's the stories about religion, it was all about the about the rationale behind the war, which is always money. And so we started editing this book, and slowly and gradually we decided to, it became less of a photo book. Of course, we started with the whole idea of let's put the best of the 20 years photos into a book and see how that works, but it didn't work. It became a very dull photo book. And if you go back to the Pakistan picture of the demonstrations, yes, and in order to go through my work, I just made quick scans of my contact sheets, and we put it together into a PDF, because the first version didn't work. That was just basically traditional way of storytelling. You have a picture, you tell a story next to it, and that was it. And we started all over again with an entirely new edit. So I had to go through all of my work again and again, and I just made these quick scans, and we made a PDF out of these very rough, small scans. And that proved to be a visual key in order to tell the story. Because we let go of the all the traditional ideas about photography, the visual language created a very big sense of urgency. It brought a sense of urgency into the work, and from that point we started combining all types of photography into the book. And of course, when I started 25 years ago as a photographer, 20 years later, I was a completely different person, a completely different photographer. So it was also quite helpful in, it was also quite helpful way in combining all the work together.
Yeah, and seeing the different kinds of formats, cameras that you use, you already get this time inserted, this feeling of time that passes by, different eras yeah. in the world. You see that already. I think we turn to the installation, mm-hmm. to the exhibition, which is in fact a 4-channel installation.
Yeah, it's a 12-meter wide panorama with Dolby surround system, and we wanted it to be a physical experience for the viewer. So we didn't want to have this distant approach where you have, again, the images and a voiceover telling you or explaining what you're actually looking at. We just wanted to bombard the viewer with all sorts of information. So you have 4 separate screens in which most of the times 2, 3 or even more things happen at the same time. So as a viewer, you have to force yourself all the time to switch from screens, and it's basically a replication of how people nowadays consume news. You sit behind a computer, you have 1 or 2 screens, and you pick your information from a lot of sources at the same time. So we wanted to have this, we wanted to create this feeling that all things happen at the same time. There's no linear story about, you know, drugs and war. There's a small thing happening in Tajikistan, which is influencing something in the Ukraine, which bounces back to Afghanistan and then moves forward to London. And so we wanted to emphasize that a lot of things in this world, which are going on in our daily lives, are in sometimes very surprising ways connected to each other.
Yeah. Okay, thank you so much. I think this was the last slide, so I stopped sharing my screen. It works very well. I think I'd like to turn to Lisa first, because this notion of fragmentation, it also came along, of course, in Robert's talk just now. And maybe it is, I would like to know from you, if you think about this fragmented world, how and to what level did that also inform the design of your website? Because we can scroll horizontally, vertically, we can all different kind of elements, small videos, pictures. We can read the text, read even the poem. Can you elaborate a bit more on the design of the interactive website? Your mic, Lisa.
There we go. Sorry, everybody. Yes, might help if I had a mic. Yeah, I was always really keen to make something that referenced postmodernism, really, and this idea of sort of this fragmentation of society right from the outset. That, you know, extending really on from the drone project, I really wanted this project to more reference the confusion that we have when we are researching as academics or as artists, or as, you know, you start off with one direction and then before you know it, you're completely lost and 5 miles away virtually from where you began. So I always knew that I wanted to make a project that sort of referenced those early postmodern academics, you know, Derrida, Jameson, Lyotard, etc., as a way to talk about the impossibilities of representation. And this idea of the impossibility of getting to the truth, as well as documentary photographers. So the way that I understand a lot of those writers is that postmodernism had this sort of waning of effect, is that, you know, images and art had lost its effectiveness as, you know, for example, as a source of activism. And mm-hmm. Jameson always says it's better to engage in sort of these fragments and look at them as a process, because we can't actually really ever engage in history. We can't ever actually really look at history from a real perspective, because it's always been diluted by somebody writing about it. It's very difficult, or presenting it within a form that you can see through TV or publications or whatever, films. Mm-hmm. So, you know, his idea was that it's always better to look at the fragments and to sort of consider all the different ways in which stories can be represented, rather than not doing it at all and going, oh my God, that story is too overwhelming, I can't approach it. I mean, it's similar to Robert in some way. It's like, how do you represent such a huge story, really? And gold was one of those things, you know, there was no small story within it. So I sort of seeked out these small stories, and some ways of representing were just through a very small YouTube clip, you know, from the woman that's on the website, you know, is that you have one particular idea of Obama, and then you realize that actually, oh, okay, he's passed a bill to allow any American to exploit any asteroid in space. Hang on a minute. That, you know, it's those contradictions that I think are really interesting. So, you know, the best way to talk about that was actually just by showing a little bit of film footage. And as I said earlier about the women and the gold and the materiality. So these sort of different snippets and fragments sort of connect to this idea of, A, how we search for stories and how we interact with media, but also, mm-hmm. you know, the impossibilities of finding the truth.
Yeah. Okay. And maybe, Robert, you'd like to add a bit to what Lisa is already mentioning about fragmentation and all the snippets and not being able to get a whole story, and maybe then in relation to how you designed the interactive?
Well, I think we instinctively follow the same line as Lisa, as a way of thinking and as a way of designing the interactive documentary. And for us, it was very important to have this element that everything is, because of the digitalization of media, everything is happening in the now, which was a really important element that the whole idea of that something happened in the past and that's all gone and it's not important anymore, is we try to circumvent that and make clear that things that happened 25 years ago somewhere in a remote place still affect our lives in 2020. And for us, the big issue was how to, as a viewer, how a viewer would be able to understand that all. We really struggled with the issue of how do you make clear that these things, which are at a first glance not connected, but how do you start to tell, or how do you assemble all those small stories into a cohesive narrative? And in the end, it proved to be ourselves, because we've been walking around in that story for 20 years. So for us, that proved to be the key, I think. And I think as a documentary maker nowadays, it makes much more sense, or your work has a lot more value if you don't focus too much on certain issues or certain events, but rather, like Lisa and me, try to create a much broader narrative on the topic and create an entirely different angle. Because if you really start to research stories, you will find out that the story itself, which you read about, you know, for 6 months in the newspaper, is much more complex. It's much more many angles. Often very surprising details, which turns your whole perspective upside down. And that's what we try to do with the Poppy Project.
Yeah.
Create an entirely new narrative about war in the 21st century.
Yeah, exactly. Hey, I just saw my phone that we are already on for an hour. And so I think it's about time. to also let the audience ask some questions. So I turn to Malte, because he will be moderating the questions.
Yes, there are actually some. And I'll start with one that was posed to Lisa, which are actually three questions. I'll just read it for you. Which all technology you use to present your work on website? Could you please share some inputs on those graphs and projections? When you work on a project, do you preconceive this idea of projection?
I can see the question now. Well, unfortunately, I used, I don't know if this answers the question, but I used a program by Adobe that's no longer available or no longer being updated, which is fairly disastrous. And the name has completely gone out of my brain at the moment, but don't use it. it was all, you know, we spent quite a lot of money working within this sort of web design system from Adobe, and now it's gone, it's disappeared. So, I mean, golly, that is such a, I think that's a real issue within website platforms as well, how to navigate and find the best platform for you to make your work. And with regards to sort of embedding, you know, different technologies and graphics, and I mean, there are all sorts of, you know, especially with gold, there are so many graphs and data places that show you, you know, when it's gone up, when it's gone down. I mean, I've got a live graph within the website that shows you obviously the up and down of the gold. And, you know, there is always something out there. And then it's just a question of embedding it within the website. I mean, I worked with a designer called Alejandro Akin from IC Visual Lab, who's actually now involved in the new Bristol Biennale that's coming up, and he's got his fingers, and you know, he also published Amat Mahmoudian's book. But do I preconceive any of that? Absolutely not. I mean, the only things that I preconceive are the sort of initial narratives and the ideas, and then these things are uncovered through research. I know that I want to go to Peru. And then obviously things emerge. And that's, of course, you can't, you can't pre-visualize everything if you're a documentary photographer or artist, because things change, you know. And that's something that I really discovered with the Gold Project, is that I would say something about a particular idea, and then literally 3 months later, you know, that area had been completely closed down and wasn't relevant anymore. And I think that's the issue with these big unwieldy projects, is that you sort of, because time is linear, you sort of, when do you update something that you discovered 20 years ago? I mean, maybe Robert could say something more about that, but, you know, if you're presenting something in a publication, you want to have the up-to-date material. But if you actually did the original photography, in my case, it was four years ago, then some of that information that you would include has shifted and changed. So that's something that's very interesting to negotiate, how you do that. And so for me personally, a bit like Robert, is that I just take my position and the facts at the time that I did it, rather than, you know, what the relevance is of the information now. So some things inevitably will be out of date, and that's documentary. Yeah. That's how it works. But I don't know, Robert, you might have something to say.
Yeah, no, I agree. There's not much more to add, I would say.
Well, there's a question which maybe goes into the same direction, which was directed to you, Robert. It says, when you work on different or new visual languages, how do you predict if this will be accepted by galleries or photo editors? What would be your advice for emerging photographers who are working on personal projects?
I never think about whether somebody will like the work or not. My only criteria is, does it work or not? So I never work towards a goal in the back of my head, oh, somebody I know or a gallery or anybody should like that. It just doesn't work that way. You collect all your materials. And as Lisa said, once you're out in the field, most of your ideas and plans collapse within 24 hours, because all you had planned, for some reason or not, it just doesn't work. And most of the time, for logistical reasons. So it's very hard to plan. And at the same time, once you've collected all your material, you just start, you know, editing and putting stories together. And you just, at some point, you have a sort of a vague idea of what you want to do. But in our case, when we work for, you know, 7 or 8 years on one story, you start out with this very simple idea, and the story shifts about 4 or 5 times. And in the end, you have something you're pleased with, and it's a very often quite frustrating process, because a lot of the times you get stuck, and a lot of the times your ideas just don't work, and then you need to start all over again. So it's basically, you just have to follow your instincts as a creative person and work your way through it. And I think it's important to allow yourself the time to create your own narrative and your own ideas about the story. And it just takes time to develop those ideas about what is it exactly that I want to say with this project. Because you have the sort of the first layer in the proper project was, of course, you know, the drug trafficking. But in the end, it became a story about globalization, about war in the 21st century. And you go through various stages throughout the years before you get to that conclusion. Hang on, it's actually a story about something completely different. So we started out in Afghanistan, and we never imagined when we did this story that we would end up in Mali.
Yeah, true.
Yeah, I just wanted to add just quickly on that, is that one of the recommendations that I have for for anybody that's involved in documentary is don't assume when you get somewhere that you've got all the answers and that you'll just photograph that thing. Because as sure as hell, you're going to get back and 6 months later, you'll realize that actually you've missed the story because you thought the story was this thing and actually it's now become something else. So photograph everything and anybody because you don't know how you're going to use that material when you get back. I don't know if it's the same for you, Robert, but I expect you ended up making a lot of material that you didn't use and some material that you thought that you wouldn't use and have actually used. You know, so I think that that's the biggest mistake that young documentary photographers make is that they go with a very preconceived, specific idea. Oh, I'm going to photograph that. They spend £2,000 getting there and getting the access, and they don't see outside of the thing that they're photographing. You know, they don't see laterally around the subject enough.
Yes, I completely agree. Most of the times I use the stuff I wasn't planning to use, or I just bumped along the way into it.
Maybe
it's also good to go a bit into the changes that especially in Robert's career, but I think it applies to Lisa as well, is indeed making work for magazines, doing short stuff, but also then turn with your work to the museum and use the museum space for material that is more documentary, more photojournalistic, but then find a way that it can also work in a contemporary art environment. And then the question is, what is then the value for you of showing your work in the museum, and do you treat it then differently? What is the, how do you work with that? I don't know who wants to start.
Robert.
I think in at some point we decided that being a journalist wasn't enough anymore, and I think the point where we said, well, this is an entirely different ball game was 2001 when we were with 4,500 journalists in Islamabad in Pakistan, all trying to get into Afghanistan. There were about 1,500 waiting in Iran and about 1,000 in Tajikistan. And we sort of realized that this circus, which all of a sudden was there out of nowhere, was just not gonna cut it anymore. And from that moment on, we decided to follow a different approach and go into the long-term documentary projects. And in the end, it was a quite a bumpy road because we soon realized that you're sort of stuck in between. You're making stories or doing work which is too big for the average newspaper to run or to finance. And at the same time, the art world or the world of museums and galleries still regard you as a photojournalist. So you're always stuck in between. And that's quite a difficult position. I think in the end we managed, especially with Poppy, because that was simply too big for the traditional media to handle. It was quite a funny experience. And we ended up in the museum environment. And it's a space where you can do a lot more, where you can tell a lot more layered stories. You have a lot more freedom than working for traditional media, because those are basically very simple stories from A to B. They often have to refer to what's going on at the moment, and that's about it. And after, 15 years of doing that, we just decided to follow another path or route.
True. Malte, are there any other questions you'd like to pose to Lisa, Robert, from the audience?
Actually, still quite a questions we have. People are typing. One that might fit to what Robert just said is just coming in from YouTube, which is, Was there a point when things became too complex so no one would understand? And how did you deal with that? I mean, seeing the broad topics that both of you tackled with your works, maybe this question can go to both of you, Lisa and Robert.
I mean, for me, that's absolutely 100% what I find the most exciting aspect of what I do, is to negotiate that balance. And for me, slightly different maybe from Robert, but that is all about the viewer, is that, you know, if my mother doesn't understand what I'm doing, then do you know what I mean? It doesn't sort of make, it's not going to make sense to anybody that doesn't know anything about photography or gold. So it is, I always think it is always about trying to hold that balance between, you know, being true to your interest in your concept and your ideas, but also making something accessible. And I think that that's what's really interesting about photography at the moment, is that it has become visually very complex and complicated. And, you know, if something is too text heavy, is too fragmented, then nobody's going to spend any time looking at it. Everybody's going to find it so hard and impenetrable to engage with that you're going to lose your audience. And ultimately, you know, where I'm a visual artist, so for me, the visuals have to come through, and it's then a question of, you know, thinking about the balance between text, you know, and imagery. And that's something that publishers do really well, is that they do have an understanding. And there are different types of publishers that have more text or less text. You know, so Michael Mack is very visual. This book that I did with him was incredibly unusual for him to have text in any book that wasn't a theory book. And then he actually ended up doing the whole year around sort of text and imagery. So I think that balance is something that does come with experience a little bit, but also showing your work to a lot of people and a lot of different people, and not just people within your sort of photo bubble, people that are outside of and don't have any understanding about how images work. And if they lose what you're trying to do, then you need to step back and be your harshest critic and make sure that people can access it. But I think that, for me, I find that balance really exciting. I had so many different edits of my book and showed, you know, and then people would say, well, I don't get, why are you going from, you know, from Peru to China? And then you have to question, well, why am I going from Peru to China within the book? You know, what mm-hmm. is it that weaves that narrative together? And I expect it's the same for you, Robert, really, from that point of view.
Yeah. I mean, especially with the interactive documentary, it was quite a struggle to make it understandable. You need to have a vehicle through which you can navigate, and that can either be a person or, you know, a little cartoonish kind of thing which takes you through the whole thing. We even decided at a point to just, you know, to to make it less interactive, so once you started the first video, it would go automatically into the second one and then into the third one. And then we decided to bring back, because that didn't work either, then we decided to bring back the element of that as a viewer you could navigate by yourself. So it was quite complicated, and in the end we decided to give the viewer, because at the first model of the interactive, we didn't have the free routes, and that proved to be, for outsiders, they just didn't know how to navigate, they didn't understand the story. So we introduced the free routes into the project, which is the main arteries through which the Afghan heroine goes from Afghanistan into Europe and elsewhere. That was the northern route, the southern route, and the Balkan route, which goes through the Middle East, and you have the northern route, which goes through Russia into Europe, and then you have the southern route, which is more or less the new kid on the block, which goes from Afghanistan into Africa, and then it moves straight into Southern America. And that proved to be a vital key for people to hold on to, and through which they could navigate.
And also the narration, Robert, I mean, it's the same, isn't it? Is that's you know, if you're looking at a film or theatre, you know, it's the narrator, isn't it, that keeps, or the person that's doing the audio that has a lot to say of holding things together.
Yes.
Throughout the project, you know, for me, it's the sort of clicking on the little nanoparticles, and you have this female voice talking you through what you're seeing a little bit. So providing that sort of context to the work or the images that you're seeing, which I think is really important with interactive work.
Yeah.
You know, so not assuming that people are getting it as they're looking at it. There's something that holds your hand a little bit throughout it.
Yeah, exactly. And luckily I have a lovely wife who has a very nice voice, and she had about, you know, 15, 20 years of radio experience. And I will argue that the whole Poppy project, the part of the video installation, as well as the interactive documentary, is all about audio, not so much the photography. That just plays a minor role in the whole project. It was Antoinette's radio archive on which we built the video installation, as well as the interactive documentary.
Yeah. That's true. Hey, looking at time again, I have one thing that I would like to put on the table, let's say, and that has to do with the fact that you both include fragments, snippets again, clips from YouTube or still photography from archives. But maybe let's focus on extracting fragments from YouTube. So the question is then, what made you do that? Why this choice? How does it relate to your own material? Maybe you can elaborate a bit on that. Maybe start with Lisa.
Yeah, and there's sort of a question here as well that I'm looking on the chat that's sort of about this idea of actualization of a project, which is sort of really connected, I suppose. You know, the thing about a book is that it's a very static project. Once you've put in the material, that's it, you can't change it. The beauty of web docs is that you can utilize things that are on the web. You know, you can have links to YouTube video. You have to be quite careful of copyright, obviously. I mean, archival material I only use if I've got permission. YouTube, links to YouTube, if they're on YouTube, I do tend to use them. You know, how many people realistically are going to be looking at it, and why would they have an issue with you sharing something unless the context really changes? So I think that web docs for me, or interactive websites, are a fantastic way to utilize material and to bring in ideas of things, you know, in a way that simplifies them. You know, so if, you know, I can't go to an asteroid and photograph an asteroid. Yeah. So, you know, but that narrative was really important to me. So I used NASA, I went to NASA, I used 3D material that was free to use online. I used, you know, obviously YouTube clips. So I think that that's the real beauty of doing web docs, and that doesn't come through in a book. So I think they're a really important addition to the canon of the documentary photography now. And you can use film. I use quite a lot of film that I make, which again gives you a different aesthetic, a different relationship. Other than photography, you can have audio. It's really important, narration.
Yeah, I see another question popping up. Maybe that's nice, because it's another topic we didn't cover yet. It's about audiences. Maybe it's a good question for Robert for the Poppy project. The question is there in the end an intention to return or reintroduce the works in the context of where they originated from?
You mean that we take the work we produced back to the countries where we actually produced it?
Yeah, if I remember well, we had we produced this one screen also for that reason.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And at a certain moment, it was shown in, not in Afghanistan, if I remember well, but.
No, I think it was Tajikistan, as far as I know.
It was Tajikistan, sure. Yeah. Maybe you can know about that experience.
Well, we always try to do that, but it's quite complicated. just for financial and logistical reasons. Quite a monumental task to, you know, organize something as an exhibition in Afghanistan or in Pakistan or Tajikistan. So we always try to, and sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. We just finished a new book about the Fukushima disaster in Japan. And of course we'd like to take it to Japan, but whether we will succeed or not, it's not up to us.
I'm not really particularly, I don't make work with the motivation of showing it within a gallery. I'm more motivated by publications and more recently by web docs. And of course the advantage of having that is that, you know, they are free to use and they are free to view and they can be disseminated quite easily. I mean, I'm still quite traditional in that, you know, I sent all the women that I've worked with prints of the people that I work with. But for me, I don't know, it wouldn't particularly make sense for me to go and do a PowerPoint presentation of portraits of all of the women in the Atacama Desert. But I have sent them all prints. So, you know, it's always important for documentary photographers. I mean, I never ever tell a student that, you know, if they take a photo of somebody, they have to make sure they have a way of getting them a photo or at least offering them a photo.
Yeah.
Or,
yeah. That's what we do as well. I often used to take Polaroid photos along, which you just make a photograph and you have an instance photograph which you can show to the people you photograph, so they have an idea whether it looks nice or not, and sometimes they say no, that's not going to work out. It's a very direct way of interacting with somebody you have to work with. And of course, like Lisa, we always send the material back to people.
Yeah. I see two further questions that might be interesting. There's one that's really practical, but important, of course, also for emergence journalists, young journalists. Do you apply for grants for this kind of work?
Yes.
Can inform us a little bit, Lisa, first?
Yeah. I mean, I couldn't have made this. I was awarded the Getty Images Prestige Grant that I had to apply for, and that paid for it. And also, you know, I'm lucky enough to be attached to the University of South Wales, who are fantastic at funding projects. So, you know, it was supported by my university as well, as it's considered, you know, research in the sense of looking at new modes of documentary practices. So the thing about funding applications is that once you've got one funding application, you know how the system works. And I think even Iris, you said to me, actually, if it's a good project, it will always get funded. And I think that that's true. If you get funding applications right and you work really, really hard, to do them properly and take advice. I mean, Natasha Caruana is doing some great work, Show Grow, free Instagram sort of advice, tutorials about, you know, applying for funding and things. It's a fantastic way to support your career. Pretty much the only way to support your career, because you're, you know, if you think that you're going to sell lots of work and prints, definitely think again. But funding, there are so many places that will fund projects. I don't know how it's going to be after the COVID nightmare, but I think we all have to assume that there will be money around to apply for.
Do you want to add something, Robert?
No, I agree. I mean, all of our projects rely on funding and grants and subsidies. And it's actually a large part of the project is trying to get the funding, but it also forces you to become very clear and very specific about what you want to do. It's also a way of forcing you to really think through your own project, which in the end will save you a lot of time and a lot of money.
Absolutely.
It's a very useful process.
Yeah. I think it's absolutely invaluable for you to question your motivations and yourself and what you're doing. And each question within a funding application is absolutely designed. You know, why are you doing this? Who is your audience? How many people are you going to be viewing it? Where they're going to be viewing it? All of those things, which help you answer those questions and then determine how you're going to make something. So I think that process is invaluable, but God, it's really sounds... takes a lot of work. It's really
a lot of work. Yeah, true. Yeah, it takes ages.
Months.
Yeah.
My university now says that they will you put within your funding application funding to have a sabbatical in order to write the funding application, because they take so much. You know, there's an expectation that you are working them on all day, every day for about 3 to 6 months. So yeah. You know, they do take a long time, but once you've done one,
you can hit the next.
Yes, exactly.
Hey, I'd like to close this session with one final question that was also that's also coming from the chat. That is about access, because you are both have been in areas and people that are not really easy to approach. So maybe, or it would be nice if you can both come up with an example of maybe where it was super easy to come in to your surprise, and maybe the other way around, where it was really, really hard to get access to sort of kind of whatever organization, people, or maybe that's a nice closing question.
Mm-hmm. Well, one story actually happened in Albania. We had been trying to get into a prison in Tirana, and we spent months corresponding with the prison director. We involved an NGO which works inside of the prison and tried to get into the prison through them. And after months of negotiations, we got the permission. So we traveled to Albania, especially for that project. So we were allowed into the prison for about 2-3 hours. We got a guided tour, and then they just, you know, moved us very kind and very gently outside of the prison, and that was it. So we planned a whole trip. The whole trip was built around, you know, spending 1 or 2 weeks inside of the prison. So then you're, oh God, what am I going to do? And we decided to hang around, and we also had this very vague idea of going along with the anti-narcotics brigades, which are funded by the EU money. And we just gave them a call, and, you know, we had a chat with them. We explained what we wanted. We showed them the work we've been doing. And they said, look, you're just going to have to sit in Tirana for a couple of days. And if something pops up, we'll call you. And at some point, we just got a call. You have to be at the police station at, you know, within 20 minutes. And that was the kickoff of working with the anti-narcotics brigades. And we just kept on chasing drug dealers for the next couple of days. And it proved to be a key story, which we still lacked. And all of a sudden we had access. So when you're on a trip, you always run into stories where, you know, you don't get access, you're not able to go there because of the bad weather, roads which are blocked. But if you just hang around, there's always going to happen something new. So you have to improvise all the time.
I had a similar story in Shenzhen. When I went to Hong Kong, we had access organized through a fixer to go to an illegal gold mine in Shenzhen, and they got very twitchy and pulled it, and we'd gone all the way to Hong Kong in order to go across into southern China and to photograph in this sort of artisan illegal gold mining. It got pulled straight away, so that we then had to renegotiate and then had to find another illegal gold miner that we had no context for at all. So it was quite, it was a much trickier situation. But actually, when we got access, we had fantastic access, and it was really, really amazing. And it was much better access than we'd had from pre-planning the access. So, you know, I think it's, yeah, I mean, one door was closed and one door was opened. Yeah. In previous bodies of work, you know, it's been the same. You just go places. And I think that's why, if you go with a very specific idea of you're going to photograph one thing and your access gets pulled, you should always assume your access will get pulled, and then you can photograph and find other things to work with. You have to be flexible, which comes down again to this idea of multiple truths. You know, there isn't just one way to tell a story. There are multiple ways of telling stories, and it's really important to be flexible and not to get stressed over thinking that your way is the only way that you can photograph something. There are always different ways.
Yeah, there was your beautiful quote from the beginning, my way or the highway. Hey, I think we have been talking now for 90 minutes. So I think we have got a lot of information about your projects. Of course, I would love to ask everyone who had been attending this talk to go to their websites of Lisa Barnard and of Robert Knoth and Antoinette de Jong, and dive into it, spend some time with their work. The book of Lisa Barnard is still for sale via MacBooks. Poppy is sold out already for years. But we hope that for of both projects, we can still exhibit it somewhere in the future. Oh, there's a lovely message. And thank you so much from Canada, from Linda Kout. That's always nice to know where people are from. So thank you very much, Robert. Thank you very much, Lisa, for attending this talk. And thank you so much, Malte and Karin, for making this happen.
Thank you very much for inviting me. It's been really lovely to see everybody and to chat.
Yeah, thank all of you for being here. It's been some very nice insight into your project and works. And thank you, Iris, for hosting this. All of you can find the links to Robert's and Lisa's website also on the Lumix Festival website, where there are, together with more writing from Iris, some more snippets and insights to the different projects that are in the new exhibition, in the new Perspectives on Documentary Practices presentation. We will also continue tomorrow with another entire day of program, which is titled Storytellers of the Future. In the evening, there will be another live talk. In the afternoon, there will be another live talk. In the afternoon, it's Fred Richen, the former dean of the ICP, who will talk more about even different forms of journalistic practices and modes for the future. And in the evening at 8 p.m., there will be a presentation by Misha Vallejo, who is also in the competition program of the Lumix Festival, who will launch his brand new website, interactive digital website project that he presented for the Lumix Festival. So thank you very much for attending, everybody. And last but not least, I want to thank the 7th Photo Agency, who made it possible for us to present or use their Zoom platform for us to make these events and live talks possible. Thank you, everybody, and see you soon.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you.